the southern tip of Australia, that's Tasmania, New Zealand, and Antarctica. And these are seabird surveys. And actually, Kate's master's thesis is focusing on exactly these data. So you put this view together across the whole world, and now what I've done is I've shown no knowledge in gray, okay, same. Poor, incomplete knowledge in blue, and good, consistent, apparently complete knowledge in red. Okay? So again, what you're seeing is large parts of the Earth with no red. So what I've done as a way of essentially giving us a status report of knowledge of the birds of the world is I've taken a frequency distribution across all pixels on Earth, 1 degree pixels. And this is for terrestrial pixels, and this is for marine pixels. But this is a cumulative frequency distribution. So the pixels with perfectly documented avifaunas are out here, and you can see there are very few. And a few are 80 or 90% complete. And a few more are at least 20% complete, and most of them are unknown. Okay? So that's a pretty sad story about the status of bird information that is digital and accessible. Okay? Essentially every other taxon will be worse. What we're in the midst of doing right now is trying to track these indices of completeness through time. So you go back to the earliest versions of the GBIF data set, the GBIF index, and go from about 2008 to present. And what we want to see is whether this line goes up through time, indicating a bit more, a bit more, a bit more knowledge. I can definitely tell you, for example, here's Australia, and you can see it's mostly unknown as of this version. But when the Atlas of Living Australia came online and became a strong participant, essentially all of Australia glimpsed to red because it's quite good knowledge. It just wasn't both digital and easily accessible. Okay? So that's places. Now let's look at taxa. Okay? I showed you birds. That's another visualization of bird data. That's actually right off of the GBIF page. But where you see red is a lot of records, and where you see yellow is fewer records, and where you see blue is no records. So that's birds. That's plants. Actually, plants are, there's some coverage for a lot of the surface of the Earth. Mammals, you see a few bigger holes, but pretty good coverage. Now let's go into the sad realm. There's insects of any sort. There's mosquitoes. There's sandflies. And then if you really like pain, there's viruses of any sort. Okay? My point is very simple. If you get very far from vertebrates and a few other groups, you're going to be in for a lot of trouble. Okay? Your knowledge, your accessible and digital information is going to be very, very sparse. These are just the realities of biodiversity information. Another reality is you have to look across institutions. So this is going back to the Mexico example, and this is showing you just four institutions. The Natural History Museum in Paris and the British Museum both had very old collections. Remember I showed you the first day that most knowledge that is in European museums about Mexican birds is from the 19th century. Well, these are those collections. And what you can see, especially for the British Museum, is you can see the oldest roads that gave access into remote parts of Mexico. Field Museum, a little bit better, though you can still see those same roads. And then the University of Kansas, where I work right now, is actually quite good, mainly because there was an entomologist at the museum in the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, and he sent collectors all over Mexico to collect mammals, but they were accumulating birds as they went. So we actually have very nice, well-dispersed collections. Now, it makes it sound like, well, forget about the other three, go to the University of Kansas. But notice this. The University of Kansas has essentially no specimens from the Baja Peninsula. We'd have to go to the Field Museum for those. So the lesson is, you can accumulate a pretty complete knowledge of birds across Mexico. The biggest circles you see are more than 4,000 specimens taken from a single grid cell. But look at this accumulation curve. This is the number of museums, the Field Museum, the Paris Museum, the British Museum, Kansas, etc. And this is the proportion of the total of specimens. So if I want to see half of the specimens that exist, that's right here, I have to visit 9 or 10 collections. If I want to see 90%, I have to go to the top 20, 25 collections. Okay? And by the way, you don't know which are the top 25 collections until you go. Okay? So another big lesson about biodiversity information is that you absolutely have to work across multiple institutions. You can't say, I can just go to the X museum, or I can just use my institution's data set, and I have enough information. There's more information out there. Unless you're working on a very, very small question, you know, the biodiversity of this square meter of carpet. If you're working at all on regional scales, there's information out there. And you just have to hunt it down. Okay. So you guys work in Africa. I'm not going to presume to tell you much about Africa, but what I will do is give you some reflections. Here is a bit of information on African data in GFIF. By my calculations, there are 12.5 million records that pertain to African biodiversity in GFIF. Obviously, those records are not distributed evenly across taxa and across space. How much more is out there? Where are those data? And what's the best way to accumulate those data? In fact, I can tell you right now that 2/3 of the digital accessible knowledge of the biodiversity of Africa come from one country. Can anybody guess which one it is? I heard it. I'm hearing somebody say South Africa. Yeah, that's true. So, here's a visualization. In red, you see the countries with the richest biodiversity information, digitally accessible. South Africa with 8 million records. Madagascar with just over 5 million. Just over a half million. Then in purple, we see basically between a quarter and a half million. In light mauve, we see about 100,000. And down here in dark gray and black, we see countries that have essentially no information available. Now, that looks like a lot of information for those purple and red areas. But that's split across birds and plants and calendula and butterflies, and you may actually find that the information here and the information here refer to completely different taxonomic groups and may be completely incompatible. So that's not good enough. That's not even close to good enough. Now I want to show you something else. This is for each one of the countries that has data over here. This is the percent of those data that is served from the country. Okay, which is to say, you can see the standout is South Africa, which serves 95% of those 8 million records that pertain to South Africa. Now, these blue countries are between 1 and 3. Here we have some 10 to 40. But what I'm trying to show you is it's very few countries in Africa that are serving data. I think we have representatives of most of the countries here that are indeed serving. But the point is that the African countries are not participating broadly. Okay? There are two reasons for that. One is something that we've talked about. I don't want to share my data because I'm worried that somebody else will take it. I don't want to give up that exclusive command of my data. We'll come back to that. Here's the other reason. This is the total number of records served, records that pertain to Africa, but served by institutions outside of the home country. So for example, South Africa serves data on a bunch of other countries, especially in Southern Africa, and to some degree, other countries in Africa have a little bit of data about other countries. But look at the bright colors, reds and purples, they're in North America and Europe. And so what we're seeing is essentially most of the data about African biodiversity are coming from outside. Okay? And that's good and that's bad. Partly it's saying, well, the data that do exist in Africa, we need to mobilize this data. Each one of you comes from an institution that has data of some sort. That's biodiversity data. And the question is, how do we mobilize this data? How do we, each one of us, put what we have on the table so that everybody around the table can learn? Okay? But the other side of the coin is, how do we get access to all of the information about African biodiversity that is sitting in other countries? So here's an interesting set of graphics. I took the other countries that are serving more than 5,000 records of African biodiversity, again, any taxon, and you can see it's Belgium, Benin, Denmark, France, Germany, Netherlands, South Africa, Sweden, Tanzania, United Kingdom, and the US. So again, these are countries serving data about other countries. Okay, biodiversity in other countries. Now, let's look at Kenya. 3/4 of the biodiversity data that is digital and accessible for Kenya are being served by US institutions. And the rest come from a broad spectrum of countries. Tanzania is similar. A little bit more of a participation from Belgium, a little bit more from the UK, but really, it's the US. Here's the DRC and here's Burundi. Both tell very similar stories. Belgium, okay? And a little bit from the US. There's Ethiopia, there's Benin. That's all I can fit on the screen, otherwise I would put all of your countries up. Ethiopia and Benin, you see the Netherlands entering in rather strongly, and then some from Germany,